Thank you. not good at it yet. You have to almost bring it to me. Who's that I'm looking at?
We're the paparazzi. We're here to make you stars.
Oh, yo, yo. Thank you.
What do you like to say to Rabbi Volka?
I like to wish him all the best and a good and healthy year. And wish him Mazel Tov and his children all the best. And that we don't want him to leave, but I am so happy to see him.
Okay, you know he's not retiring, eh?
No.
He's not?
No.
He's going to be a rabbi all his life.
That's good. I'm so happy he's going to be a rabbi.
Okay. Right.
And I miss him.
Okay.
Hi, Roger.
What do you like to say to Rabbi Volka?
Rabbi Volka, the community and the Jewish community and the whole community will never be the same without you. So you better stay a long time with us.
Of course.
Okay?
Well, you know,
and you know who it is, eh? It's Maura Henny. Remember.
He says he's not retiring. He refuses to retire.
That's right. Keep going.
All right.
That's what you tell me all the time. Keep going, Henny. So I'm here, still in the school, so you can be in the... We'll walk out together one day.
All right. Okay. How about here? What would you like to say to Rabbi Volka?
We're going
to
miss him here at the synagogue very much. It won't be the same place without him.
But he's not going anywhere.
He's not going anywhere?
He's not retiring.
Well, then, that's great. We'll look forward to seeing him.
Okay. How about you, sir?
I guess I'd thank him for all the great things he's done for me, personally.
Oh, really?
How about here?
You think of his family. Take care of you well. Bye-bye.
How about here? What would you like to say to Rabbi Volka?
Enjoy your retirement. I know you'll never retire, but I hope to spend time with family and friends.
Remind me after.
All right. How about here? Hi there. Oh, she doesn't want to be on camera. Okay. All right. How about you, sir? What would you like to say to Rabbi Volka?
Rabbi, I'm so happy to be here, Rabbi.
Okay. Okay. All right. You know he's not retiring, eh?
I know that.
All right. Okay.
I know, Rabbi.
All right. Okay. How about here?
Same thing. We're delighted to be here for such a nice, pleasant day and occasion. Thank you.
Okay. And how about here? What would you like to say to Rabbi Volka?
Thank you very much, Rabbi, for everything that you've done for the shul, the community, our families, and ourselves. Thank you very much and be well.
Okay. All right. Hi.
Oh, hello.
What would you like to say to Rabbi Volka?
Well, I would like to thank him for all the guidance he's provided over so many years. And also his willingness to, at the drop of a button, head hither and yon to attend any event that affected any of us. So thank you very much, Rab.
Okay. Hello, ladies. Hi there.
Hi.
Okay, what would you like to say to Rabbi Volka today?
All right, here
we go. Well, what do I want to say? We will miss him a lot.
But he's not going anywhere.
Yes, exactly. And we have him. We have his good stories, and I've known him for the past 30 years. That's a long time. So.
Okay. All right. How about here? What's your favorite memory of Rabbi Volka?
Oh, my favorite memory? I don't know, maybe.
That's a tough one, eh?
Yeah, I've known him since I was born. He gave me my name. He was my bat mitzvah. There are lots of great memories. At my nephew's Brit Milah, he's always there and very sociable and friendly and gives advice. So I can't choose one memory, but
okay.
All the praise.
All right. Enjoy the party.
Thank you.
What would you like to say to Rabbi Volka on this occasion?
Anything. It would be a big, big thank you.
All right. And how about here? Oh.
All right.
Talk to you in the middle of eating there.
That's all right. Rabbi Volka knows me. I'm always eating. I would echo Hans's thoughts. Very big, big thank you for all the years he's been here, for all the help he's given us personally, and the community in general. We're deeply indebted to him, and it will be very difficult to find somebody with the same talents and the same feelings for the community.
There's only one Rabbi Volka.
Well, there's only one Rabbi Volka, but there's also only one Rabbi Bucher with the talents and with the empathy that he brings towards the rabbinate. Other rabbis can be a rabbi as such, but when you have somebody who has the interpersonal skills, the interpersonal relationships that he's built up over the last 40 years or so, it's quite exceptional.
Yeah.
So a big thank you.
The new rabbi will have a challenge, but I think he'll fit in very well.
Well, the new rabbi is the new rabbi, and one should not compare the two of them. One cannot compare one rabbi who's beginning his career with one rabbi who's ending his career. Okay. So this is a new chapter in Machzik Hadass. So big thank you to Rabbi Bucher from Elena and Roger Keane.
Rabbi Bucher on this occasion.
Which occasion? Every occasion when Rabbi Bucher is an occasion anyways. Nothing different about this one, just that he's the one celebrating this time. He always makes the mess for everybody. We're going to try to make the most for him over here. Mazel tov.
Mazel tov. What would you like to say to Rabbi Bucher on this occasion?
Thank you very much, Rabbi Bucher, for all you've done for Ottawa. We wish you much success in your future endeavors.
Thank you. What would you like to say to Rabbi
Bucher? Rabbi Bucher, we have lots of nachas from you. And you deserve it.
I'm supposed to talk now?
Yeah.
I said everything I had to say already, Daddy. It's in the book, it's on the video. I don't like talking about videos.
Okay.
I did enough of that.
Mazel tov. What would you like to say to Rabbi Bucher on this occasion?
Mazel tov. See many more children and grandchildren
have. Okay, I think we didn't hear that, but that's okay.
How are you? Good, how are you?
Well, I felt very good.
Okay, there we go. Hi. What do you know, like to say to Rabbi Bucher?
I'd like to say to Rabbi Bucher, thank you for marrying us 40 years ago. It's still working.
He did a good job.
You did a good job. Thank you very much.
It worked. We're still together.
Absolutely.
All right.
Wonderful.
Wonderful.
Hi there.
What would you like to say to Rabbi Bucher on this occasion?
We love you and we appreciate your service to the community for all these years. Look forward to more times together.
That's a beautiful thing to say. We love you. Very good.
There you go.
How about here?
I echo my husband's sentiments and we love you. Thanks for everything.
All right, okay. What would you like to say to Rabbi Bucher on this occasion?
Well, for me, it's not the end. We're going to keep on seeing him. And we wish him mazel tov and everything should be well.
Very good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi. How are you? No.
You don't want to be on camera.
Yes. No, thanks.
Okay, how about if this beautiful lady here speaks for you? What would you like to say to Rabbi Bucher on this occasion?
He's a very successful man and with so many honorees.
That's it?
He's the man.
Okay, all right. Hi there.
Hello.
What would you like to say to Rabbi Bucher on this occasion?
I'm going to be speaking a little later, so you'll probably hear too much of what I'm going to say.
You're saying a speech?
No, it's a presentation.
Presentation.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
So you can get me then.
We will.
Okay.
The future. Hi, Mom. Hi.
Hi.
So, what would you like to say to Rabbi Bucher?
I'd rather say to him, he should have many, many more happy, healthy years ahead.
All right.
And keep going.
Lots of knockouts.
A lot of everything.
And mazel tov. All right.
And same to you.
Hi there. Hi.
Oh, hi.
What would you like to say to Rabbi Bucher on this occasion?
Which occasion?
Well, it's Tuvia today.
What?
Second Tuvia today.
Oh, second of... of the infinity tributes that are that you deserve, so I guess we're getting closer. Mazel tov, and we're very proud of you, of course. And
You didn't get to see the dinner the last...
I actually saw it live streaming. I watched it from Baltimore, and it was wonderful.
What did you think of that?
I thought that was amazing. I understand this is not going to be as fancy, but that's right. Probably better.
All right, okay. You know, I'm the one who did that.
The video?
The live streaming, yeah.
It was great. It was amazing because I felt like, you know, we kind of split up. You know, half the family came then and that, and I felt like I was there almost. It was great.
Awesome. Very good. Thank you. Enjoy the day.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. How about here? Hello, gentlemen. Hi there. Hi. What would you like to say to Rabbi Bulka on this occasion?
He had a very good run. He's a great athlete. The legs go first. I wish him even more happiness and nakas in the future, and may he always have good health. And my daughter really looks upon him as their one and only rabbi. My daughter Karen really appreciated him when she was very young.
Now, he's from New York, so if he'd been playing professional baseball, which team do you think you would pick? The Yankees or the Mets?
Blue Jays.
The Blue Jays!
He still has a role. He can be a rabbi to... He can be rabbi to a couple of teams.
Yeah, yeah. Well, he's still good at that, eh? There we go. All right, thanks. All right. Hello, gentlemen. Hi, sorry to interrupt your conversation here. I just want to ask you, what would you like to say to Rabbi Bulka? I think I already got you, didn't I?
You did. Get him.
Okay, how about you? Sir, what would you like to say to Rabbi Bulka?
I will say, Mazel Tov. Ottawa is so special thanks to Rabbi Bulka. I remember playing basketball with him when we were 13. He made us come to Minion and play basketball with us afterwards, football, whatever. He's unique in every way. Kept Canada together with his prayer for Canada. So many things, can't even cover it.
Now that comes up with a good point. Do you think as a rabbi, he's above average as an athlete for a rabbi?
Superior for a rabbi, right? Oh yeah.
So he's a good example to other rabbis.
He's a hard act to follow in every measure.
Okay, in every measure.
Metrics weren't made for Rabbi Bulka because he blows them all away.
Okay, if he'd been playing professional baseball, which team do you think he would have played for mostly?
Oh, he was a New Yorker, wasn't he?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Had to be a New Yorker. Oh, I don't know. I don't know.
They would have been lucky to have him.
I've never seen him play hockey, though.
Okay. Oh, we got to get him on the ice. Okay, good point.
Have to get him on the ice.
Okay. Maybe we can replace Jason Spezza with him there on the ice.
Perhaps.
Yeah. Okay.
All the best.
To Rabbi Bulka on...
Just a big mazel tov and a career well done, the incredible impact you've made on this community, and good luck going into the future.
What's your favorite memory of Rabbi Bulka?
Rabbi Bulka married my husband and I about 5 years ago. And that was one of the first times I heard Rabbi Bulka speak under our chuppah, and just the way that he played with our names was... My first introduction. He did.
Awesome.
Yeah. Yeah.
5 years.
Almost 5 years.
Wonderful. Okay. Enjoy the evening.
Thank you.
Hello.
What would you like to say to Rabbi Bulka?
Mazal Tov. From 1972 to today, he's been terrific. Everything that anybody could ever dream for in a rabbi, he's given us. And we're going to miss him. Well, we're not going to miss him. We're not going to let him... His title has changed, but he's going to stick around as long as we can do something about that.
You know, one thing I just noticed? You say Mazal Tov the same way he does. Everyone else says Mazal Tov.
I guess it's conditioning.
It's a cultural thing.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Hello.
Oh, she doesn't want me on camera. Okay, let's get this gentleman here on camera. Hi.
Hello, hello.
What would you like to say to Rabbi Bulka?
What's it, Rabbi Bulka? I mean, Rabbi Bulka has been my family's Rav, married my parents and my sister's wedding, officiated at my wedding, he officiated, was at my bris, my bar mitzvah.
Wow.
So it's been my family's Rav for,
he covered,
you know,
all the bases.
All the bases. He really got the grand slam there. So just tremendous, you know, gratitude and appreciation for guidance and everything all the way through life. So, thank you.
He's affected so many people's lives, hasn't
yeah.
he?
Yeah, tremendous, tremendous, tremendous amount of people's lives.
Into our lives.
Yeah, tremendous amount of goodness into my life, everyone's life, and it just, you know, he set the tone for this community in which I was raised from the youngest age, and, you know, it gave me the platform onto which to go to, you know, other things in other cities and do other things, but the root of it was always really here in his leadership and guidance, and I'm really appreciative of that.
What about his kindness campaign? Isn't that something?
The kindness campaign is just something remarkable, to show one small idea that can really blossom into something humongous, so really something tremendous. So that's it.
All right. Enjoy the evening.
Thank you so much.
We'd like to wish Saba together a loud, big, one, two, and boisterous. Sorry, loud, big, and boisterous. One, two, three, mazel tov!
Mazel tov!
So come on, wait. Wait
for
the camera.
Let's try it once more time. One, two, three,
mazel tov!
There we go. There, you can see yourself. There you are.
No, no, that's you.
That's you.
That's you. Hello.
Pretty? You're pretty. All right, okay. All right.
Thank you.
Oh, not too big a piece now. Not too big a piece. So we got him on camera before he's taking that piece of cake there. Even if it's kosher, too much is not good for you. Hi there.
Hi.
What would you like to say to Rabbi Volk on this occasion?
I think it's a wonderful occasion, and I wish him all the luck in his future endeavors. Of course, he's going to be around, so...
He's not really retired.
No, he's not really.
Only officially, but unofficially.
Right, unofficially.
He's sticking around.
And he's great. That's all I can say.
Okay.
Thank you.
What would you like to say to Rabbi Volk?
Just want to wish him the very best. He's been wonderful for all these years. All the very best, Rabbi.
Okay. Bregman here. Hi there. Hi.
Hello.
You don't like being on camera too much, do you? You didn't mind on your wedding day, but today, let's just do it just for a minute.
Let's say we're less nervous about it today.
Yeah.
Hi, Rabbi Volk. And mazel tov to you and Leah. Have a wonderful future ahead of you. We're so grateful for everything you've done. Are you going to ask me something, or that's good enough?
What's your favorite memory of Rabbi Volk? That's a tough one.
Oh, that's complicated.
So many.
Yes, many, many. And I probably, the one that comes to mind is one, I won't mention names, but in Montreal, at a Sephardi shul and having a wedding with Sephardi and Ashkenazi customs. That was quite beautiful and very memorable.
All right, thank you for sharing.
Thank you.
This is a family event. There you go. Hi there. Hi.
Hi.
What would you like to say to Rabbi Volk on this occasion?
Ladies and gentlemen.
Well, we haven't lived in Ottawa in a long time, but we miss him.
We're ready to start the program.
He married in Aviv in Montreal. We're always grateful and wonderful memories.
We'll give you 2 minutes. Please find the seat. Take your last little drink. And we're going to start a very short and interesting program. Thank you. Welcome to an afternoon with Rabbi Volk, in appreciation for 47 years as the spiritual leader of Machzikei Hadas. It was a great honor to be asked by our president, Jonah Rabinovich, to be the MC for this afternoon's program. But I have to tell you, I've been thinking about it all week as to what a daunting task it is to be here in front of so many friends and family of the rabbi and be your MC. I was thinking actually that I felt like Elizabeth Taylor's sixth husband. I knew what I have to do, but how do I make it interesting? One of the first things I wanted to ask was from a congregation, from who is here this afternoon, who was actually a member, if you or your family was a member of Machzikei Hadas when the rabbi started at our shul 47 years ago? Please stand up. Let's see who's here. Let's give all these people a round of applause. Today is an afternoon to say thanks to the rabbi for 47 years of leadership, inspiration, advice, counseling, and teaching. The event at the Chateau Laurier was the shul's way of honoring the rabbi for not only what he has done for our congregation, but for what he has contributed to the Ottawa Jewish community, the Canadian Jewish community, the international Jewish community, and his contributions as a proud Canadian, and how he has made Canada a better country for all its citizens. Our event today, as I see it, is a more focused event centered on Maksiki Hadass and our way to say thank you to Rabbi Bulka for his contribution, guidance, leadership, and wisdom to our members and friends of our shul. This is the place in a small shul down on Murray Street where it all began 47 years ago when the rabbi, just 23 years old, fresh out of yeshiva and successfully interviewing for his first pulpit job, moved to Ottawa with his new bride, Naomi, to begin their married life together. Rabbi Bulka's rabbinical journey in Ottawa has been filled with accomplishments, simchas, ups and downs in life, challenges, opportunities, and unimaginable results and achievements that I doubt even he envisioned when he first moved to our nation's capital in 1967. Due to limited time, I can't go into every organization within the Jewish community or outside the Jewish community in which Rabbi Bulka has left a significant and indelible impression. I urge you to take home and read carefully the congratulatory messages in the tribute book produced for the gala dinner last week to read firsthand what his peers and co-workers are saying about his contributions. As we all know, rabbi or rav means a teacher. However, in our case, and for all of our benefit, our rabbi's designation and title as Rabbi Bulka is more than a teacher. Each of us here today views Rabbi Bulka through different glasses, but we all share a multifaceted view of what he means to us. When I think of Rabbi Bulka, I think of a man who is not only a teacher and a Torah scholar, but also a mentor, a baseball player, a tour guide for trips to Israel, to Washington, to the Ottawa Senators game, an MC for community events, a voice of reason at organizational meetings, a broadcaster, an author of books, the initiator of Hug a Vet phenomena, a storyteller, a good judge of character, a reader of Megillah Ruth with his stop and go sign, a melodic shofar blower, the 1-2-3 Mazel Tov guy during our announcements, a fast yet clear Torah reader, a person who makes every simcha, every bris, bar mitzvah or wedding special, a genealogy specialist for Ottawa Jewish families, a gematria maven, a rock and a person of comfort during loss or troubled times in our life, an advocate for blood donation and organ transplants, a master of puns, a caring and a loving husband, father, grandfather, son, son-in-law, and sibling. A man who accomplishes more things in one 24-hour period than many other people accomplish in 1 month. And above all, a man who exudes and demonstrates optimism, kindness, intelligence, and friendliness to everyone, regardless of who you are, where you come from, what you do, and your level of religious affiliation. This afternoon, we, the congregants who make up Maksiki Hadass family, have the opportunity to say thank you to Rabbi Bulka for all he has done and all he will continue to do for our community and other communities as a new phase in his life begins. I now want to call on Chazen Levinson, who will lead us, and please stand in singing of O Canada and Hatikvah.
O Canada, Rome native land, true patriot love, in all thy sons command, with glory God, with Caesar rise, the tune of strong and free. From far and wide, O Canada, we stand on guard for thee. God keep our land glorious and free. Oh,
stand on guard for thee. Call on Maneva Penima, Nefesh Yehudi Omiya, Ulefate Mizrach Kadima.
Thank you, Chazan. It gives me great pleasure to call upon the leader from the board's perspective of the shul, Jonah Rabinovich, who has done a tremendous amount of work, some we see, and a lot we don't see that goes on behind the scenes. And for those of you that are sitting here who are past presidents of the shul, you know the amount of hours it takes to make this shul tick and move along. We've had a number of significant changes in the last couple of years that hopefully will put the shul on a strong footing as we move ahead in the next century for the growth and well-being of our shul. So please help me welcome, and also by your applause, let's thank Jonah for all his work. The president of our shul, Jonah Rabinovich.
Thanks everybody for being here. I'm not going to, I'll keep it brief, but really what I want to do today is take this opportunity to thank everybody. I'm going to go ahead and do that. First of all, I want to thank Paul. I asked Paul to be the MC, and I couldn't think of anybody better. He's been a long-standing member of the shul, a man of tremendous wit and charm, and I think he's doing a great job so far. So big thank you to Paul Breglin. I want to thank the volunteers who pulled this event together. So I want to thank from the office, Michelle Pulvermacher, Jordana Vered, Charlie Wiseman, Suzanne Bregman, Jaime Reichstein, Marlene Reichstein. Am I missing anybody? Probably. Well, Blanche, of course, it goes without saying, absolutely. Nathan, of course. Nathan, thank you for your wonderful supervision today. But thank you very much, everybody, who helped make this this afternoon possible. You deserve a big thank you. finally, I want to just take a moment to talk about Rabbi Bolka, if possible. Because I think of all the people here, he deserves the biggest thanks. And I think it's a testament that there's four generations of his family here in the room today, from his mother-in-law, his several of his children, a whole bunch of grandchildren. Unfortunately, even the great-grandchild couldn't make it. That would have been five generations. But four generations, a big, beautiful family came to celebrate with the rabbi. And, I think, Rabbi, just look around at all the people who are standing room only, quite literally, putting out more chairs. So it's a tremendous success, a tremendous reflection of everybody's love for you and everybody's care. And I think love is the right word to describe what we feel for you. And I think it behooves us all to really say a big thank you to you for everything you've done. You've done so much for the shul, so much for the city, so much for the province, the country, and even world Jewry. You know, you've been there through, specifically with this shul, but this is really about the shul. You've been there for us in good times and not so good times. You've been there with a compassionate ear, with a patience, and you've reciprocated that love that we've all felt for you. And we couldn't ask for a more amazing human being to be the leader of the shul. I think everybody here has been at the gala last week. Somebody asked who's been touched by Rabbi Bulka. It was a person from the Cancer Foundation. Typically at an event they say who's been touched by cancer, everybody stands up. At this event they asked who's been touched by Rabbi Bulka, and everybody stood up there too. And you know, just a truly, truly amazing man. Somebody we owe a great deal of thanks and hakarat hatov to, because really, Rabbi, without you, the shul would not be what it is. The community would not be what it is. And really, all of us here would not be who we are. So a real sincere thank you to you for everything. And finally, just thanks to everybody for coming today. It's wonderful to see so many people enjoying the delicious food from Creative Kosher Catering. So thank you, everybody. Enjoy the remainder of the afternoon. And we want to see you all back here very soon.
Thank you, President Jonah. The next part of our afternoon is a Devar Torah by Rabbi Boka's youngest son, Binyamin. But before we call him up, I wanted to say a few words about Rabbi Boka's family. Rabbi Boka's accomplishments would not have been possible without the love and support of his family. The life of a pulpit rabbi is sometimes unpredictable. A rabbi's family has to be prepared for an irregular schedule from the man of the house. Well-prepared family plans can be disrupted by an emergency session with a troubled or sick congregant. A funeral can replace a family outing or gathering. Family life can be restricted in time as the rabbi is tending to shul business and events, giving advice, preparing speeches, giving bar mitzvah advice, visiting the sick, attending weddings within or outside Ottawa, and just being called on for members of the congregation. The rabbi's family must be supportive and understanding. They must be flexible and know the rabbi cannot always be on time for birthday parties, anniversaries, school plays or events, or family trips. We, the congregants, have been blessed, and so has our rabbi, with the understanding, love, and patience of the whole Boka family. The rabbi has been blessed with two devoted wives, the late Naomi and Rebbetzin Leah. I remember Leah in her dignified and unassuming way, helping out at sisterhood functions, giving the Devar Torah at the start of each event. What did I say? Okay, I remember Naomi in her dignified and unassuming way, helping out at sisterhood functions, giving the Devar Torah at the start of each event, supporting the rabbi during all of his activities, providing halacha advice and help to the women of our congregation, and taking on family responsibilities by herself when the rabbi was busy with congregants. I also thank Leah for being so involved with our members and being part of our shul life. It was a big change for Leah to come from the multifaceted and convenient Jewish life of New York to the small and weather-challenged life of Ottawa, Canada. And I also want to thank and recognize each of the Boka children for generously sharing their father's time with the Maksiki Hadass family. Some of them are here this afternoon, and I specifically want to extend a big and appreciative Todah Rabah to all of Rabbi Boka's children, Yocheved, Shmuel, Rina, Eliezer, and Binyamin. Today, we have here with us Yocheved, Eliezer, and Binyamin. Would you please stand and be recognized? And lastly, I want to thank Rabbi Bulka for sharing his parents, the late, may their blessed memory, Rabbi and Mrs. Bulka with her congregation, plus his parents-in-law, the late of blessed memory, Mr. Jacobovitz, and Mrs. Jacobovitz, who is here with us this afternoon. Welcome. And I fondly remember the Divrei Torah that Rabbi Bulka Sr. and Mr. Jacobovitz shared with the congregation on many occasions. And Naomi's brother, Ronnie, is also here with us as well, so welcome to Ronnie. So for all the Bulka family, the extended family, please join me in an appreciative, thankful, Todah Rabah to the entire Bulka family. One, two, three.
Todah Rabah.
And with that, it gives me great pleasure to call on Binyamin, who has come all the way from Jerusalem to be with us this afternoon and to share some Torah thoughts with us. Binyamin?
I see they haven't given up on me being a rabbi. They put rabbi in the program. They even told me I have 3 minutes to speak. So I'm gonna cut to the chase. It's very, very special to be able to make the big trip, to be able to be here today and to share in all of the I guess we'll call them festivities. It's a once in a lifetime opportunity and it's very special to be part of it. We have in this week's Torah portion, we have the story of the confrontation between the Korach takes against Moshe Rabbeinu, and it's very puzzling. Korach seems to come with a very compelling claim. The entire nation is holy. Every single person listened to God speaking to them on Har Sinai. Sounds like a man of the people. And Moshe Rabbeinu's reaction is an adverse reaction, anti-Korach. He, unlike any other episode in the entire Torah, he prays for Korach's undoing and for his demise, which is to be effectively eliminated from the world. And it needs understanding. If we take a closer look at it, the claim of the entire nation is holy, and they all listened, they all heard Hashem speak to them in Har Sinai. Korach was putting every single individual on the same pedestal, on equal footing. It sounds great on the surface, but really that is the source and its root of fragmentation. A nation is not every single person on the same footing. A nation is made up of different people with different talents, different abilities, different skills, and they're supposed to complement each other to make an entire whole. Moshe Rabbeinu saw that in the root of the claim that everybody is on the same level is really pursuit for personal power and domination. And a true leader sees the differences and the qualities of each individual and is able to handle and able to tend to each and every individual's needs and foster every single individual's abilities. It requires the ability to walk the tightrope of being there for the people, standing up with it, taking initiative to lead, but at the same time not investing an ounce of selfishness. somebody whose pursuit is power is brings rise to a coup, and that's what was going on, and that needs to be eliminated immediately. We have been blessed for the past 47 years to have the best trapezist of them all. The one, my father, who has this uncanny ability to be there for every single individual, to carefully tend to every individual's needs, and at the same time bear in mind and be able to handle the community at large and keep everything intact and keep everything in its perfect, everything in symphony perfect, and to run the community for 47 years. At the same time, without not investing a single ounce of selfishness. The selflessness, which is what's necessary for a job like this, is something which I can't even fathom how it could possibly be matched. It's a big source that we have. And I want to give a bracha to the community, as we are taking, the community now is taking a step in a step forward, we'll call it, that they should continue to grow and continue to be guided properly no matter who, what, where, and how, in the same vein. And give a bracha to my father that wherever life takes him from now and onward, that this is not, what he exhibited in these 47 years is not a happenstance. It's something which is in his fiber. And I'm sure, and I give the bracha that wherever he continues, it should shine wherever he goes. And finally, I want everybody to join me, and I think this is something which, this is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity, so we better make it good. He'll never, ever let ever again. To have a loud, boisterous, intercontinental, 1, 2, 3, Toda Rabba.
And now we're going to show you a video presentation that was prepared especially for the tribute dinner we had at the Chateau Laurier about 10 days ago and the event that we're having here this afternoon. But before we do that, I would like Rabbi Bolka to come forward for a moment. And we have a videographer by the name of Eric Kujala, who's here this afternoon, who's been videoing the afternoon festivities. And he also videotaped the festivities at the Chateau Laurier 10 days ago. So Eric, do you want to come up? I need your help here for a minute.
Sure.
So Eric's not a member of our congregation.
Yet.
Yet. I want to tell you what a mensch this guy is. When he heard about the rabbi's dinner at the Chateau Laurier, he called up the shul and he volunteered to video the entire proceedings from start to finish and put it online at no cost out of his love and respect for Rabbi Bolka. And furthermore, when I saw him that evening at the event, we reconnected because Eric was the videographer at the 58th Yom HaTzmut celebration that I chaired when we moved Yom HaTzmut from the JCC to a venue outside the JCC. For those that remember, that was, 8 years ago, at the Civic Center. And Eric was the videographer then. And so we connected and I said to him, Eric, how would you like to come on Sunday when we have an event for members of our congregation to video the festivities? And without hesitation, Eric said yes. So Eric, thank you very much.
Most of you recognize me. I've been actually with the Jewish community for almost 25 years, and I've been to so many simchas and bar mitzvahs here, and I have to tell you that I really, as someone from the outside, I was welcomed into this community, and I'm glad to be part of it. Thank you.
I now would call on the rabbi and Jonah for a special presentation for Eric. Oh, okay. Good.
So this this is a book called An Unforgettable Hour. Nothing to do with this. This is when we received our coat of arms. This is co-signed by Jonah and myself. It's given to you.
Thank you.
Together with the coat of arms itself.
Oh, wow.
It's not the Order of Canada, but it's close.
It means just as much to me. Thank you. Thank you, Rabbi.
Okay, I'm going to be technically challenged. I'm going to start the video for you, so hang on for one second.
Rabbi Bolka was actually born in London, England on June 6, 1944, D-Day. He grew up in New York. His father was a rabbi in the Bronx. And Rabbi Bolka came here at the tender young age of 23 when the synagogue was downtown on Murray Street. And in 1973, the synagogue moved to its current location in Alta Vista. And he's been with us 47 years.
When I came here, the people that were in the hiring committee, they were interested already in moving to a new neighborhood and asked if I would stay on for that long if I was hired. I made a promise to the congregation in Ottawa that if there's a possibility of moving, I would not turn my back on them. The city decided yes, and the rest is history.
I would describe Rabbi Bolka as a wise and gentle person with a wonderful sense of humor.
The list of qualities that he just embodies are unlimited.
Rabbi Bolka is aggressively kind. He's stubbornly gentle.
He's an inspiring person. He's a visionary person. He's a person that looks at the big picture and realizes what truly is important.
He's wise and he's compassionate.
He doesn't do anything halfway. If he gets into something, he's completely into it.
I don't know what I have built, but I can tell you what I wanted to build. And that was a congregation in which every single segment of the community could feel welcome, that it didn't make a difference, your intensity of your engagement. Of course, we'd like people to be engaged in some way or another.
Probably not a board that he hasn't served on in Ottawa. He's a busy, busy human being, but has just the biggest heart in the world.
His best accomplishment is the fact that he has the time, the ability to be able to participate in all these areas to make our lives as an Ottawan, our lives as an Ontarian, and our lives as a Canadian a better place to live in.
He's helped shape our community and other communities with the work that he has done.
I think some of his greatest accomplishments is the fact that he's reached out to other faiths, whether it's Muslim, Christian, Buddhist, and just brought people together in a spirit of fellowship and peace and harmony.
He's the kind of person that can make anybody feel like $1 million with his great smile and with his encouraging words. He just has this way of making people feel amazing.
When God created Rabbi Bolka, he threw away the mold. There's no one in the world like him. He's a very fine, wise, kind human being.
It has not gone unrecognized by the Governor General and by the Government of Canada, and it's not gone unrecognized by the people who follow Rabbi Bolka and follow in his footsteps in his leadership. And I'm very proud of the rabbi for this recognition, but it is well deserved, and I want to congratulate him.
Rabbi Bolka came to Canada in 1967. That's the year that the Order of Canada was created. We believe it's so fitting that after so many years and decades of helping our local community, but also our country, that Canada has chosen to recognize him with the Order of Canada.
He's one of the true Canadians that is deserving of that national recognition.
I would say that the most thrilling part of it was that my wife and my four kids who are in North America all came in for it. That sort of gave it a nice feel that this was an event that they cherished, and for that, that was worth it all.
We have to be good people before we can be good Jews, and Rabbi Bolka really exemplifies that. It's not enough to be an observant Jew. You have to be a good person to be a genuine Jew, and I think Rabbi Bolka personifies that to a T.
It's never about himself. It's never about what he can do for his own good. It's always about, what does this person need? What can I do for them? How can I make their lives better?
Seeing members of the congregation happy and fulfilled, that's, you know, say, well, what is it all about? If it becomes a meeting place and people meet and they actually then get married, this is great to see.
And when you come to him for his wisdom, you think that at that moment you are the most special person in his life at that moment. He's so intent in listening to you.
He knows everything. Whatever you want to ask, ask Rabbi Bolka.
He has a large congregation. He knows so many people, again, not just in Ottawa, but across the country and in other countries. And he just seems to be able to take that time and just be a real true human being.
Despite living in a climate here in Ottawa that is not the most hospitable, refuses to wear an overcoat. He's in complete denial about that need. He recognizes that for the most part, his trips are from his car to a warm building, and so he just refuses to do it.
My brother, who's in the clothing industry in Montreal, Rabbi Bolka always asks him, he has to get him a polyester suit. My brother says, well, they don't make polyester suits anymore. And because he probably takes a shower in that suit. I don't know, but he plays baseball in that suit. He fills in grave sites in that suit in the winter. And I remember he went to my brother's place and he picked up his suit, and it was a wool suit. He just can't wear it. He just wears that polyester suit. And if anybody out there knows where you can get a polyester suit, get him one or two, please.
The people that know Rabbi Bolka know he always has a pocket full of treats. He always has treats wherever he goes. And he'll take you for ice cream at the drop of a hat, and he has candies on him, and he brings cookies, and it's never shortage of treats.
After the services on Saturday morning, that's when we have our biggest crowd Saturday morning, and there's a birthday cake or a cake celebrating something else, Rabbi Bolka is the only one allowed to cut the cake. He will grab the knife from you in midair. Looks like a sword fight at times, but Rabbi Bolka is the only person who can cut the cake.
As a newspaper man, he makes his deadlines. I would send out questions, and often within an hour I have the answers. They're the right length, they're timely, they're always very insightful and knowledgeable, of course.
I always joke with Rabbi Bolka, he gets more press coverage than I do as mayor, and I'm very jealous about that. He's got a radio show, he had a TV show, he writes a column in the Ottawa Citizen, he's in much demand as a public speaker.
He's charismatic in the way he presents his points of view and very knowledgeable.
I'm just glad he never ran for mayor.
If somebody said to me, what do I need to do in order to build a legacy? I would say the first thing you got to do is stop thinking about building a legacy. Think just about doing good things. Think about whatever you can do to increase community engagement, be involved, be there for people when they need you.
13 months ago, I was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer. Somebody told me a bad day only lasts 24 hours. And I can tell you, when you finish those 24 hours with Rabbi Bolka, that bad day is definitely over, and I move forward. So I am so thankful for Rabbi Bolka.
I think his legacy is kindness. And it's gone so far that he's taken this initiative, Kindness Week, so far in Ottawa, and it's done such great things for our city that it's actually being modeled in other cities.
There are people who lead by running ahead of the pack, and there are people who lead by pushing you forward. He's led by walking beside you in good times and bad times, and that is true leadership.
He is the glue that holds our Jewish community in Ottawa together.
The one person standing behind my father all these years was our dear mother, and she was with him for 32 years, and my father would never be where he is today if it wasn't for our dear mother.
Without question, it's the people that I'm going to miss the most. The bricks, I mean, can always when nobody's looking, I can steal a brick and take it with me. Nobody will know, but it's the people, because it's the people that make this place what it is.
He will always be part of the community, and we hope that he intends to keep his fine touch in our community, because his blessings to the city of Ottawa have been immense.
Rabbi Bulka, you've been a great leader in the Jewish community in Ottawa, but you've, more important than that, have been a great Canadian leader, someone who has brought people together from all walks of life to make our country a better place. But most importantly to me, you've been a great friend.
Daddy, we wish we could be there in person. Unfortunately, it's such a long trip, but we wanted to wish you Mazel Tov on all your accomplishments. It's truly amazing.
Thank you for inspiring us. Thank you for helping so many people in the community. I'm proud to call you my friend.
I'm always in awe of your background, what you've brought to this city.
The Cancer Foundation is able to do what it's doing today in our community because you're there, as you are for so many other people.
You really, truly stand up for our Torah values, and we cherish that.
You inspire so many, and all of us are here tonight to thank you for what you've brought to our lives each and every day.
I think the legacy you leave to citizen readers, to the city of Ottawa, and indeed to the country, is a great one.
I want to thank you for all the work you've done, and personally, I want to thank you for being there for me always.
Rabbi Bulka, I want to thank you for teaching and inspiring us how to be better people.
You are the moral compass. When we think about what's the right thing to do, what's the wrong thing to do, we think, what would Daddy do? What would Saba do?
You're a rabbi for our people. You are probably the quintessential example of what Frumkeit is all about. You're good, you're kind, you're an ambassador for us as a people, not only in the Jewish community, but for the people at large.
You're not leaving us yet. We will continue to see you here. We will continue to work together over the next little while. I want to wish you the best, and you and your family.
Daddy, you've always been a truly wonderful example to all of us, an example of leadership on all different levels, leadership on the family level, leadership on the community level, leadership on the national level, and it's something that we certainly hope not only will continue, but will also continue to rub off on us and our children.
You're an extraordinary man, beloved by all, and I think it behooves me to wish you a loud, boisterous 1, 2, 3, Todah Rabah.
Don't think about us back here too much. Just spend that time with the family that they have done without you all these years, and they deserve you now. We got you all these years, and now they get to get you.
We will all be happy, hopefully, to have you a little bit closer by, Emir Tzah Hashem, and may we see a lot of nachas.
Thank you, and I wish you Godspeed and good continuation in your fine work.
And remember, you're the best guy that we all have ever known. EFF forever.
When I became chief of police 2 years ago, I had coins minted. And these coins are important to me in my office. And on one side, there's a coat of arms and there's my name, so you'll know who it comes from. But more importantly, on the reverse side, there's a philosophy that I brought as chief of police, in that everyone matters. And I think everybody in our community is important, and every member of the police service is important. And I give these coins out to people that reflect those values. And I can't think of a better person to award this coin to than to you. It's not the Order of Canada, but it is an important coin because you've demonstrated the philosophy and the approach that everyone does matter and that everybody can make an impact in our community. So thank you so much for your contribution to our community. And the next time I see you in person, I will give you this coin.
Today, I was thrilled to see that you received the Order of Canada, and I wish you continued good health and much success in your retirement. I know you won't really retire.
Well, here I have the opportunity to say whatever I feel like to whomever I feel like. It's one of those opportunities that is great to have, but be careful what you wish for. What I wish for all of you is that you should find fulfillment in your life, in good health, to derive joy from your family and your friends, and to thank you all for all of the interactions we've had over the years. There have been some upside ones, some downside ones, but in all of them, I really valued the connection and the ability to relate on a human level with all of you, to see the greatness that actually inheres in all of you, and to appreciate your own achievements, whether it's within your family, within the community, at your jobs, whatever. It's been one of those things that has been on all levels, uplifting, encouraging, energizing, and truly inspirational. So to all of you, thank you so much. And whatever you are doing, continue to do it and to do it well. God bless you all.
You know, I've always wanted to make an introduction for someone who I can honestly say needs no introduction. This afternoon, I get the chance to do that. So please join me in giving a rousing, thunderous, grateful, appreciative, provincial, federal, North American, international, and here's a new one, intergalactic applause to our guest of honor, our very own Rabbi Boca. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. The notice for this said this is going from 3 to 5, so the good news is that my speech can't be more than 20 minutes. But I hope to make it for a lot less. Thank you very much, Paul. Thank you very much to everyone who has made this day possible, made the other day possible. I did a little bit of the math. 470 at Chateau Laurier, 250 here. That's something like, 720 people that are happy to see me go. Thanks, Eric. 400 more online. That's pretty good. Okay. I very much appreciate everyone being here today. The reason why we're doing this here, a lot of people said that the event that we had at the Chateau really should have been here. But that was a standalone celebration that major purpose was really to set the shul on a good financial footing. And I hope that it succeeded in that. Certainly there were so many people who worked so hard to make it happen. And they've all been thanked, so I don't want to be repetitious, but they know how much I appreciate everything that they've done. And today really is for family, for Mishpocha. There are many that expressed their regrets that they couldn't make it. But it gives me a chance to reflect on a few things. Number one, Paul was very right about how important family is. And there are so many people here today. My kids, their spouses have been all extraordinary. And the children they've given birth to, also extraordinary. But I would like to make a special mention of the family matriarch, who coming here today was not an easy task. She gets around all over the place. It's amazing. She has so many children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, all the way, all over the world. Hardly ever misses a simcha. And she is the glue that keeps the entire family together. Omar Jacobowitz sitting over there very modestly. I wouldn't mind if he gave her a standing ovation. One, two, three. And I think I am pretty well accurate in this. There's one person in this room today that was on the original selection committee. And believe it or not, we still talk to each other. That's Bert Koenig. Bert? There are some very interesting what might have beens and what could have beens that I look back over the course of time. The most cherished thing about being a rabbi is the people that you meet. And I'm looking around in the room here today. Everyone here I have a personal connection to at all sorts of different levels. And I've grown to appreciate the multifaceted nature of human beings, their strengths, their capacities, their determination, their resolve, their courage, their strength. It's really been inspirational to me to see this. And I remember there was a time that when I came here to Shul, we had trouble finding a parking space. And it reminds me of the old story of a leader of a congregation who constantly, whenever he came, his parking place was taken by someone else. And they didn't know, they put no parking signs, they put, if you park here, you're doomed to, you know what. Nothing helped. Finally, somebody came up with a great idea that was the pièce de résistance. They said, you park, you preach. So, I've been parking, I've been preaching, but truthfully, I never liked the idea of being a preacher. Because I learned very early on in life not to tell people what to do. People are smart. They know what to do. And many people in different circumstances, they're challenged by the circumstances. And the one thing that we are told in Pirkei Avot is al todin et chavercho asher tagil en komo, never to judge a person until you reach their stage in life or their position. We can't judge. And finally, funnily enough, I've seen things in my life that are truly mind-boggling. I've seen people, and I look at them and say, how could you still be alive? What gives you the strength? There are people who've swallowed tons of chemo. What drives them? I look at that and say, if God forbid it happened, how many people would be able to withstand it? You see this amazing resilience in the human spirit that I've seen in so many of you. And it's been truly inspirational. I remember at the event that we had a little while ago that our good friend Jason Kenny started fooling around with gematria. Now, how many countries have a minister of employment and immigration who will fool around with gematria, which basically is the Hebrew numerical equivalent of words? We are blessed to have such in our country. And I figured, here we are today. Nobody really has a gathering for someone for their 47th anniversary in the congregation. It's a funny number. 40, I understand. 50, I understand. 47 is really odd. So I took the Jason Kenny approach and said, okay, what is the gematria of 47? Turns out that the gematria of 47 in Hebrew is the word degem. Dalet gimel mem. The word degem means a model. And why is this appropriate? Because if I look back and I compare and I judge based on the experiences I've had with colleagues in different congregations, if I had to pick a model of a shul and people that make it so wonderful for a rabbi to be able to function, it's Machzikei Hadas. So you may be coming here today to say thank you to me, and I'm here today to say thank you to you. And you can clap for yourself. Yes, it's perfectly okay, and maybe a little bit more robust. So not for yourself, but for everyone else around you, you deserve all that, because rabbis, to go through 47 years in the same place, either the congregation turns off the hearing aid and doesn't listen, or there's something magical. And there was something magical here for all these years. And it's not over. I'm not leaving tomorrow. And as I said at the chateau, I am not retiring. That's a dirty word in my vocabulary, and I hope never to have to retire. Maybe to recalculate according to the GPS, but that's a little way down. I just want to share with you a few signal moments in my life here that partially funny, partially very serious. When we originally came here, we arrived 3 o'clock in the morning, and we forgot the most elementary thing when you're coming is to have the key in advance. And who am I going to wake up at 3 o'clock in the morning? It's a nice way for a rabbi to start his career. Wake up the president 3 o'clock in the morning and say, hey, come over, I can't get into the house. So how did we manage it? Gott hat geholfen. The window, the front window in the house, was not locked. So we actually climbed into the house through the window. I said to him, I don't know whether this is an omen, but it's very important for us to understand, because a lot of people will say, you know what, if this is the way you started, this career is finished, right? But it didn't work out that way. There are one thing that this is going to come as a surprise to my children. We talked about how important they are in my life, but actually, you know, as we're here today, obviously nothing happens without being grateful to God for all of the blessings in life that we have. And even though it's understood, it still has to be expressed. And I am full of gratitude to God for all the blessings of life, early, middle, late, and hopefully to come. But my kids saved my life, and they don't even know it, but I can divulge it now. I don't know exactly the year, but it was early on that I took them to the CNE. I don't know why we were in Toronto, maybe we went there purposely, but to go to the Central Canada Exhibition, the Canadian National Exhibition, in the place where the Toronto Argonauts used to play football. Anyway, I went there to give them a good time, and as you were walking in, there's this place which seems very unobtrusive. You climb up a number of stairs, and you have to do it fast. Up, down, up, down, up, down. And it'll tell you what type of a shape you're in. So I thought, yeah, I'm in mid-20s. What could be bad? I'm going to do it and show how good a shape I'm in. I go up, down, up, down, up, down. And after that, the guy looks at me, and he says, do you exercise? Why do I have to exercise? I'm, you know, on the peak of my strength. Why? He says, if you don't start exercising, you're going to be dead in a year. That's what he told me. And I didn't doubt him. I didn't go check this. Well, he said, you know, you're not in shape. So from then on till today, I have continued to exercise. And it's my kids who brought me to the CNE that actually saved my life. But they don't know that. Now they know that. And by the way, just as a historical aside, there were three steps there. So the 1, 2, 3 Mazel Tov comes from the CNE. On a more serious note, I remember the very tragic times that many of you have gone through in life, the happy times that many of you have gone through in life. And obviously, if we have a choice, we always like the happy stuff. But I have full admiration to all of you for the courage that you have shown. And on a personal level, also for the empathy that you showed when we went through a really trying time in our lives. And that was when our beloved son, Ephraim, was taken away from us. He was 2 months old, a victim of what they called then sudden infant death syndrome. And I remember vividly the tears on many of your faces, the sense of frustration. What do we say? How do we comfort you? That's all you have to do, by the way. There's no magical words. You don't have to have formulas that say, oh, he's in a better place, and this type of stuff. This is all really gibberish. Even just saying nothing, but just looking disconsolate is all that you need to impart a message of I really care for you and what is happening. And I remember that very vividly. And I also remember that this was a turning point in my own lifetime, but I didn't know it at the time. Because after this happened, it was at a time when other children were suffering the same fate, to the extent that there was a group that had been formed here in Ottawa, which was bereaved parents of Ontario. And some or other they got a hold of me, and I started speaking to these groups about how to find comfort. And it's interesting because as a young whippersnapper coming out of school, you really have no right to even intervene with people and say, you know, everything is going to be okay. Yeah, it's not that we're looking for these things to happen, but there was a turning point at that point in time when people started saying, you know, this guy has been through something pretty horrible, and if he can come out of it, then maybe he can inspire. That was a major turning point. And it also, interestingly enough, was a major turning point in terms of my involvement with the world outside. I found, interestingly, that there were people out there thirsting, and when I say out there, I mean outside the Jewish community, thirsting for insights and help from rabbis. And that was the beginning, ironically, of a number of things. That was the beginning of my involvement outside, which, by the way, I tried my entire life not to compromise my obligations to the shul, because that was number one. So I have, throughout my life, and that's a great blessing from God, I go on overdrive. I don't drink a lot of coffee, but somehow or other I'm able to go for 4 or 5 hours of sleep a night. So I'm basically able to do lots, and it's a great blessing from God. And I think it's all having to do with, you know, keep on exercising so you're going to be in good shape. Because he passed away, it inspired me to do a book in his memory. And that was the first major book that I did, which was a commentary on Pirkei Avot, on ethics of the elders. And that started the writing trajectory. And the ultimate message in all this is that even though we're going to have low times in our lifetime, but sometimes when you look back at those low times, they actually were times in which the tide turned in a very positive direction. You can't tell people in the throes of their agony things are going to be okay, but you can, in good times, say that the way that we translate the lemons that have been given to us, and whether we decide to throw them away or make lemonade out of them, the way that we translate the things that we are challenged by in a positive way, that's what makes all the difference. So to all of you who have been an inspiration, both individually and collectively, I thank you for all that you have done. It's been a tremendous blessing to have this Degem, this Gematria of 47, this model of what a rabbi's life can and should be, and only made possible because I was blessed with having the darndest, best congregation that a rabbi could dream of. Thank you very much.
Have a seat. We just got a few more things to say. It's been a memorable afternoon, Rabbi, to be here with you and the family. At the tribute dinner, the rabbi made or said in no uncertain terms that he was not retiring. He says it's an ugly word. And I agree. I hope never to retire as well. But there comes a phase in your life when you want to re-engineer what you do with your time. So I said to myself, the rabbi is always giving to the members of the congregation. What can we as congregants give back to the rabbi in this new phase of his career. And so I've asked a few members of the congregation to give our dear rabbi some suggestions. So I'm going to call on a few of them to come forward who are going to make a presentation to the rabbi and give him some ideas about what to do with his new re-engineered phase of his life coming up. So the first person I want to call on is one of our famous choir members, Ronnie Goldberg. Rabbi, come on up.
Hey, Ronnie.
Rabbi.
Golf clubs.
Oops. I'm truly honored to be asked to participate in this tribute this afternoon. I've had many discussions with the rabbi, and invariably the subject turns to golf. As the rabbi knows, I'm what you call a golf nut. I have played golf and loved the game for over 50 years. It is a great game, and it challenges both mentally and physically, and you can play at any age. Do you realize that rabbis and golfers have many things in common? Rabbis require many years of study in Torah and Talmud and are committed to strict religious observances. Golfers, professional and occasional, constantly seek higher levels of performance by being committed to acquire the best of golf techniques. To do so, however, they must practice religiously. Rabbis and golfers sometimes live the lifestyle of gypsies, spending hours or even days away from home. Even when they're home, both are being pulled in dozens of different directions, and much is expected of them to do many things and some at the same time. Rabbinical practice involves many psychological considerations, and golfers must train their mind to train their body. So you see, Rabbi, engaging in activity such as golf should be on your radar, and it should be an easy transition for you. To help in preparing you for your venture into golf, I have a few things for you. First, this is a must read. It's a book on 1,000 reasons to love golf. Secondly, I'm pleased to present you with the official golf hat from my favorite golf course, the Riverview Golf Club. And you'll know that affixed to the cap is a ball marker that's from your favorite hockey team, the Ottawa Senators. Now, you know what the ball marker's for. When golfers are putting on the green and they have to mark where their ball lies on the green, that's what they use the ball marker for.
That's where they cheat, right?
No, they're not supposed to. Now, I have a sleeve of balls here from an organization you probably never heard of, AJIG, the American Jewish Institute of Golf. And a special presentation. This is a gift certificate that's being awarded to you for a private golf lesson from Paul Charette, renowned teacher, and Riverview's head professional. And perhaps you didn't know, but he was also the president of the Canadian Professional Golf Association. And once you've completed your lesson, this is special practice balls that you don't have to go to a golf range to practice both inside your home and outside. And lastly, this is a book of golf resorts of the world. And so on your worldly travels, perhaps you might want to stop and visit some of these golf courses someday. Anyways, Rabbi, welcome to golf. And all of them, think about
it. Rabbi, firstly, this gives me a chance to thank you so much for all the singing that you've done over the course of the years in the choir with our dear Chazon Levinson. I want to tell you a few things. Number one, you missed the big line, because the ultimate in golf is the ultimate in Jewish life. The ultimate in Jewish life is the Holy One.
Yes.
And in golf, it's a hole-in-one. Okay. The other thing I wanted to tell you is as follows. There's a famous story of a guy, I think it was Aaron Burr, I forget whatever it was, where there was sentenced. There was a duel between him and Alexander Hamilton, and Burr said to Hamilton, you know, the duel is set for tomorrow at 11 o'clock. If I don't show up, shoot without me. You can tell that to the golf pro.
What's an event with the rabbi without a good pun, right? All right, our next member is making his way up here. Rabbi, don't go away yet, put that away. We got another presentation for you here from our in-house resident artist, wood artist, is Joel Murray.
Paul invited me to be here by saying, would you be at Sunday's do? And I said, yes, I would be. Then he went on to say, would you like to be part of the program? And I said, yes, I would be very honored. And I said, well, what do I have to do? He said, well, all you have to do would be to make a presentation. And I said, well, what is the presentation? In what form? He says, it's something in wood. Now, I had a chance to do the golf thing, and it would have been very easy to make a tee. But the other thing is that I wanted you to have something that you honestly would be able to use. Sorry, Ron. If you go, well, you don't have to go. We saw this. The shelves are filled with books, and all of these books contain sources that you often refer to when there's a problem that you want a second opinion or a third opinion or what have you. Now, there is something missing there on those shelves. You're now, I don't want to use the word retired, but semi-retired. This much retired. You're going to have some free time. And with the free time, to quote King Solomon, there is a time to work and a time to play. And I think the time to play is now. But I've found when I'm dealing with Zetas and Bubbies, they don't have toys to play with. And accordingly, I did make something that you're going to be able to use as a plaything, but also as another source that you will have on the shelf. You get somebody coming to see you and he or she has chores, problems, it would be a very nice gesture on your part to play a game with them so that they're at ease and they don't have to worry. The reason I say you don't have to worry, I could have made a chess set, but it would have taken me about 2 years to make. And I then came up with this here. This is a tic-tac-toe game, and I don't think anybody will be stumped on how to play this game. Also, it's a terrific thing to have when you have grandchildren coming to visit you.
That reminds me of when I was a kid and I learned puns in school. And one day somebody came in late to class and the Rebbe asked him why he was late. He said, I had a splinter in my foot that delayed me from coming. And the Rebbe looked at him and said, you would.
I hope you're enjoying this part. Our next presenter is going to give something that the rabbis probably never thought of ever trying in his life. We're going to call her up is Henny Palmer.
I have a big bag.
You can do it. You can do it.
I have a big bag. And to you, Rabbi. Hey, since all the things that people have presented you with are indoor sports, outdoor sports, but one thing you've never thought about doing was learning to quilt.
I'm doing it on the golf course.
You won't be able to find your needles. Golfing gloves? You could play, quilting gloves. But you could play golf with them. Anyhow, Rabbi.
That's the whole...
Tons of things to learn to quilt with. Cutting boards, needles, scissors, everything for you to learn to quilt with. But most important, an honorary membership, Rabbi, to Victorious Quilts Canada. Please join the Rabbi and I tonight on CFRA when the Rabbi and I do, well, the Rabbi does, a fundraiser for Victorious Quilts Canada.
For which Henny was the major fundraiser. Thank you very, very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Rabbi.
Thank you.
So I've got the last one. Charlie Wiseman, our incoming president, had to run off a bit early, so he asked me to make the presentation, and who better than a fellow angler, myself, fisherman. Rabbi, we got one more here for you. We're going to keep you busy in your re-engineered phase. So Charlie asked me to present to you a genuine Shakespeare fishing rod. It requires a lot of patience, which I'm sure you're going to enjoy sitting out on the boat. He also asked me to give to you one of his favorite lures. The paint has been all chipped off. That's because it's been bitten a number of times by large fish, so that's a good sign that you're going to have to wait for the right fish to come along. But Charlie knew that you don't have patience to wait, so what he's giving you is a bobber to let it float, so you can be reading some Torah book or writing away on your laptop, and when this goes down under the water, you know to give a yank on the rod, and you can bring in the fish.
But Ronnie gave me four of these.
Thank you so much.
Ronnie's going to need some more lessons. And one last thing. We saw the video from that was done today. One thing I know the rabbi is going to enjoy doing. He has spent 47 years as the rabbi of this congregation. He has survived 47 years of politics in a shul environment. Now, if you can survive 47 years in a shul with all the politics that goes on, big and small, I think that the rabbi could survive politics in the real world. Would you not agree? So, ladies and gentlemen, I want you to join with me, because coming this fall, we are going to write in on the ballot, when they have a municipal election, a new Jewish candidate from Alta Vista. Let me show you what we have in mind. Just one moment. For those at the back that can't read it, it says, honesty, integrity, handshakefulness, Rabbi Bulka for mayor of Ottawa. And it says, let me become your mayor and your rabbi.
Oh, put over here.
By the way, I'll be taking contributions during dessert time. And Moksiki Hadass will be giving you tax receipts. And I also just want to say, before we conclude, there's dessert here. The rabbi's tradition is to cut the cake. I want to thank Rito Bakery and the Kardish family for doing these special cakes. Come take a look at it. They're incredible. So thank you, everyone, for joining us. And Mazel Tov, Rabbi. Many more happy, healthy years. Thank you.
Rabbi Volkman.